Should mention a little breaking news here, too, that the NHLPA just put out a statement saying Austin Watson's 27-game suspension has been reduced to 18 games by the neutral arbitrator. So quite a significant
kind of cut it in by
reduction,
third, right?
And
cut it by
really
third,
with
yeah.
no
well.
Nothing for the arbitrator to go on as far as precedent NHL-wise.
No, right. Because it's a unique one. For those who don't know, Austin Watson this summer pleaded no contest to a charge of misdemeanor domestic assault, and the league subsequently suspended him for 27 games. So, and it was 2 weeks ago Wednesday that the independent arbitrator held the appeal, and we thought there was going to be an announcement as early as Wednesday, but the arbitrator needed some more documentation. Thought it was going to carry over to next week, but obviously it's come out today. So 27 down to, you said, 18, Pierre?
18, yeah.
18 games.
And obviously, this being a hot-button topic, not in hockey, but in society, there'll be...
backlash.
There'll be a big backlash on this one, and maybe and rightfully so.
And it'll be interesting. I was just communicating with someone in the NHL. Not sure whether the league itself will respond tonight, but... the league never likes its own suspensions reduced, let's be honest. They weren't happy when Weidman's suspension was
20
reduced.
20 to 10.
So at some point in the next 24 to 48 hours, I suspect we'll hear from the league in one way or another. But it'll be interesting, to be honest, again, because everything Bob just covered, this is unprecedented territory.
Yep.
And how the league handles its public response here will be interesting. Because there's no doubt they'd be disappointed. But how will they put that into words, given
right.
everything that's at play here?
Well, I mean, they kind of have a cushion here with it being an independent arbitrator, don't they? Like,
well,
can't
yes.
they just say, sort? What do you want us
yeah,
to do?
Yeah, but they can express in no uncertain terms how unhappy they are. And what used to happen in the old days, whenever there was an independent arbitrator used, if one side or the other, the PA or the NHL, lost a grievance arbitration, there's always, I think there's usually a poison pill in there where they can gas the arbitrator.
Yeah.
And that usually happened after those things where if a ruling went against the PA, quite often they'd say, okay, next arbitrator up, let's go.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And because they both have to agree on who it is.
And the Predators just essentially put out a non-statement right now saying that they were not involved in the appeal. And as they said before, their focus is on continuing to be the health and well-being of Austin Watson and his family. So they're...
right.
They're neutral in this, but it is tough.
Which they kind of have to be.
You can't say anything.
And in the backdrop of this, now that the Austin Watson situation is clarified in terms of how many games he'll miss and what the NHL's position on it was, you've got Slava Voynov waiting in the wings. Slava mm-hmm. Voynov has made it known to the National Hockey League dating back to June, I believe, that he wants to come back to the National Hockey League.
Would it be with Los Angeles? Or
no, I don't think the Kings have interest in bringing him back. But
they would have to trade his rights, I guess, basically.
Yeah, they would have to trade his rights. And it obviously gets very complicated. In Slava Voynov's case, and again, I'm not one to try and put gradients on domestic abuse in any way, shape, or form, but if you were to compare the two police reports, there's a huge difference between the two.
Right.
In terms of the damage that was inflicted. But in any case, so Voynov, you know, he ran afoul of immigration authorities mm-hmm. and whatever because of the charges. He went back and he played in the KHL. He's indicated he wants to come back to the National Hockey League. I believe he met with I think he met with Gary Bettman earlier in the summer. I'm not 100% positive on that. But in any case, either he or his representatives met with the league, and the league basically said, you can apply to come back, but understand that there's going to be a suspension. There's going to be discipline handed down because we don't feel like we ever dealt with your situation, and they didn't. And I think Voynov and his representatives were hoping he would get time served. Time served, though, you know, going to play in the KHL and being paid millions of dollars to play in the KHL
right.
just because you couldn't play in the NHL, that doesn't mean you suffered a penalty
right.
in the eyes of the National Hockey League. So the league has had discussions, and the sense we got is that if Voynov were to return, he could be looking at 60 to 80 game, or maybe a full year suspension, which might chill the marketplace for anybody that wants to bring him back.
Right.
But
right.
It's interesting, this arbitrator's decision taking 27 down to 18, what impact might that have on the NHL in terms of the way they rule on Voynov? I don't know.
Right. Because we had heard the June draft, Bob, you and I and Dregs, that there were teams inquiring about Voynov.
Big time.
Yeah.
And, you know, listen, at the end of the day, there was a guy who was a top four right-handed defenseman on the Stanley Cup champion Kings, but obviously balancing the hit PR-wise that they would take as an organization to take on a guy with that kind of charge on him.
That's, I mean, that's the moral dilemma.
It's just
right?
not kosher.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
I mean, it's, absolutely. Well, there's a, you know, and I'd be curious to see what team it is or what teams, but we were led to believe there were multiple teams that mm-hmm. had expressed interest.
Yeah, it doesn't surprise me. I mean, look what's going on in baseball right now.
Yeah.
Houston, they said we're, you know, one strike and you're out, then all of a sudden they didn't have a closer and Roberto Osuna was available.
Yep.
Now, bit different because the charges were eventually dropped, where Voynov, I don't think there's much disputing it
right.
in terms of what he was all about, why he took off, but Houston's in the ALCS, and I think they might win another World Series. And guess who's going to be in the clubhouse party? And guess who's going to be on the streets partying with the team after they win? The fans. Not saying it's right or wrong, but teams right. eventually get to a point where they think, you know what, we can get through this wave.
And I'm not suggesting that Slava Voynov should never be allowed to play in the NHL again, but what I will tell you is if I was an owner of an NHL team, I'm not sure I want to be the team that opens a door up.
Bites the bullet.
I'm sorry if that makes me selfish or self-conscious or whatever, but to me it sends a wrong message to my fan base that I'm okay with it.
We see it, and we've seen it on a different level with Kaepernick. Regardless, I'm not talking about domestic, but I'm just saying if you may be perceived as something that would not be good for your organization, people
it's all about
shy
brand,
away from
right? It's all
now,
about brand.
And that's totally different, you know, situations, but it's more about teams just don't want that. And it's a moral issue. And personally, like, Voynov is a guy who is a terrific player, but that is an awful thing that he did, and I don't think people want that.
It's so layered and complex, and yet there are people out there that say it shouldn't be. That, you know, that if you're guilty of a heinous act, as Voynov was, that, you know, that means you forfeit your right to earn a living in the National Hockey League. And I to some degree, I understand that, but I also think, I mean, murderers get out of prison after a while, and, you know, is that wrong? Is that right? People can have that discussion all day. I think one of the important things is that it's not just a matter of punishment. If you just punish somebody, you know, what you want to do is you want to punish them for sure. But you also want to try to rehabilitate and make the person understand. And that's where it gets into a nuanced thing of, you know, and it's interesting, and again, people will say this is complex too, but Voynov is still happily married, and people say, well, that's, you know, that's not unusual in these situations, and I understand all that, but, you know, do you want this person to, you know, to be rehabilitated, to understand what they did was so heinous, but there needs to be a huge punishment, but there also needs to be, and I think it, you know, this on a much lower level, sometimes you get a player who makes a homophobic or a racial slur and everybody wants them suspended. Great, I say, sure, suspend them, fine them, do whatever. But try to make sure they understand what they did, why it was wrong, and so that it does never happen again.
Mm-hmm.
And it goes without saying that domestic abuse, you don't need to explain why it's wrong, it is. But you want that person to have a better understanding of what they did, why they did it, and why it should never, ever happen again if that person's going to be part of your league.
And right. and to a certain degree, every other teammate and player in the league.
Education.
That the message
exactly.
is beyond education. The player involved,
yeah.
but
yeah.
everyone.
Yeah. yeah.
Well, the other complicated thing here with Voynov is we haven't heard from him. We're assuming contrition, but I don't
yeah,
know.
Exactly.
Like, that's another
those
problem.
Are the things that you need to... That, you know, that's got to be all part and parcel of it too.
Because if he comes in, he's like, I'm not apologizing. I don't think I did anything wrong. Yeah. Well, then what the hell do you do? Then you got a bigger problem.
Now, and as I said, the Kings, I don't believe the Kings have any interest whatsoever in Voynov as a hockey player on their team right now, other than to perhaps facilitate to get him back into the league and move him on somewhere. But there are those within the Kings organization that believe that everything that needs to happen in one of these situations is happening, that he is on the right track and that he does understand, and that, you know, they've gone through counseling or whatever the case may be. So I don't know. There's no easy answers here. And I know the default position for a lot of people simply is, well, wash your hands of anybody who does that. Fair enough. You know, on one level, I understand that. On another level, I think everybody deserves a second chance at some point if they've gone through a really rigorous process.
Besides, I can't think of a team that needs a top four right-hand defenseman anyway.
No, yeah, never.
It's not
those guys.
It's only
about
12
teams
in the league.
Everywhere.
Like, it is.